already a late season feel this early in the ACC season as the top two teams in the conference square off tonight at the Omni in Atlanta. Hi again, everybody. I'm Brad Nessler with Clark Kellogg. A week ago, partner, we sat here and said, what's wrong with Georgia Tech? They'd lost 6 of 7. Now they've won 2 straight. Carolina, nothing wrong with them. And nothing wrong with 2 of the best freshmen in the country that we'll see tonight.
These two guys, Stephon Marbury and Antawn Jamison, have simply been fabulous freshmen all season long, in particular the last 2 games. Marbury, 17 of 33, 50 points. But Jamison, that is 81% shooting, folks. And he's posted back-to-back career highs in those last 2 games.
I've been around ACC basketball 15 years. North Carolina always sits there about 50% from the floor. It's no different this year.
It certainly is, and another testimony to the system that Dean Smith runs here. Part of the reason they get these good shots is because they're always interested in not allowing good to disrupt best. Vince Carter has a shot there at the three-point line, no go. Dante Calabria says, nope, I don't want that open 14-footer. What we want is a punch from Antawn Jamison.
North Carolina ranked 10th in the country. Dean Smith's got them playing great basketball again. We get set for the Yellow Jackets and the Tar Heels from Atlanta coming up next.
It has that feel. ACC basketball with the top two teams at 2-0 set to square off as we take a look at North Carolina's starting lineup. McInnis, Carter, Jamison, Zwicker, and Dante Calabria, again, one of the top three-point shooters in the country.
The last time out in that overtime win against Maryland, they overcame 23 turnovers by way of excellent shooting, and McInnis returned after sitting out a game and posted 9 assists.
For Georgia Tech and Bobby Cremins, Marbury and Berry in the backcourt, Harpering and Maddox up front, and Eddie Alisma, who is playing so well now down low for them.
Good shooting is an excellent elixir. Georgia Tech gave up 20 offensive rebounds to Duke, and yet you see perfect shooting from Alisma and Harpering led to them shooting 60% from the floor. Boy, take a look at, we talked about it last week, how Georgia Tech had been throwing the ball all over the place. In the last 2 games, they've cut those turnovers per game down about 6 per game, and that makes a huge difference.
Jamison, the freshman who's played brilliantly, Calabria off the break, in Carolina in a matter of moments leads 2-0. Drew Berry, whose game has come around in the last week, the senior leader for Georgia Tech. Marbury, 3 rattled out, Harpering trying to keep it alive, but it's cleared out by Vince Carter.
Both of these teams starting man-to-man. You won't see much else from Carolina, although Georgia Tech may show you some zone tonight.
Jeff McInnis nails a 3, and Carolina jumps to a 5-0 advantage. Michael Maddox back it in. Off the glass, good move. He's been a little bit quiet lately, and Tech needs him inside tonight if they're to have a chance against number 10 North Carolina.
5 of 14 in the first 2 conference games. He's better than that.
Bobby Cremins keeps reminding him of that, too. Jamison inside. Maddox contested it, and Harpering will clear off the miss. Here comes Marbury on the run. I thought he was going to backpedal and fire a 3, but he didn't.
You'll see it before the night's over, though.
That's for sure. Maddox triple team. Harpering gave up a 3. And now he's fouled. Able to catch McInnis, his first personal.
Against North Carolina, you have to be ready to take the good shots that are available. This North Carolina team will not steal the ball. None of Dean Smith's teams are noted for stealing the ball, but what they do is play good, solid position D.
Always in the right place, and usually there's 2 of them. Marbury works on Calabria.
North Carolina in his own defense here, out of the baseline, out of bounds situation.
Pack it into Alisma, over Zwicker. They got a good look. Ennis will clear it off. Carter working hard against Harper. But outside, McInnis again, this time it rattled out on him.
Somebody may have gotten shaken up, or maybe a shoestring loose.
Drew Berry kind of looked like he hobbled down court. I don't know if it was him or not. He's retying. That ankle's been a problem for a couple of years.
Right.
In fact, if you can believe it or not,
And I don't want to jinx Drew. His dad, Rick, just walked by us a couple of minutes ago before the game tipped off. He has been injured the last 2 years against North Carolina. Both times on February 12th. So it's a little earlier in the season. Maybe that'll be a good omen. Inside to Maddox. The hook this time.
Basket by Michael Maddox.
Boy, that would be a welcome sight to see Maddox get off inside and give Carolina a low post presence in addition to Alisma to think about.
Zwicker got behind Alisma. And an easy one for Serge inside. Carolina
showing zone. And again, with the short bench, Dean Smith only plays about seven people.
Stephon Marbury got his best look of the night, but that was a brick from three-point land.
The zone defense a way to be aggressive and yet protect your players from fouls as well.
McInnis, a nice crossover dribble to get that shot away, and Zwicker's there all alone for the stick back, and a five-point Carolina advantage again. Work free at the top of the key. They'll leave Alisma alone out there. Eight on the shot clock. Berry, three-pointer, short. Georgia Tech not off to the kind of start they had against Maryland a week ago in this game. Back it in to Zwicker. Surge with a hook. And the rebound comes off to Berry on the backside. Marbury got it.
Money. When he gets that kind of time, he's as good as there is at going straight up and straight down the same way every time on his jump shot. He's really one that young players can watch in terms of repeating the same motion and explosion in his jump shot.
Carter, not a good shot. Marbury will bring it. And the foul. Offensive foul against Georgia Tech. And that'll give it back to Carolina with a 9-6 lead, but it also brings us to our first timeout with 15:37 remaining first half. 9-6 Tar Heel. Stephon Marbury off to a pretty good start for Georgia Tech.
Boy, take a look at how he goes straight up and straight down. Great elevation, good movement without the orange first. Keeping active. Just comes behind Berry. Look at that elevation. Picture perfect for him. And he said, as I talked to him before the game, 25 points a game. And that's the last four outings, 64% three-point shooting. But I talked to him before the game, Brad, and he said all those hours shooting the basketball at night in the dark have allowed him to perfect his shooting stroke. And then he's got older brothers who know a little bit about
yes,
the game.
Yes, they do.
And they, too, have helped him in his development.
Eric and Don Jr. and Norman and... North Carolina with a three. Okulaju just checked in for Carolina. The only change in their lineup. Berry way outside. Calabria will pull it off the backside.
That shot will be there against that 2-3 zone after you've swung the ball from side to side.
Dante doesn't miss too many outside the arc. That one off the mark, and Carolina will keep it. Last touch by Tech.
Georgia Tech really having a problem inside with Zwicker. He's just so much bigger than anybody Tech has. He's keeping balls alive, and he's shooting right over Eddie Alisman.
This time he backs outside and buries the jumper. Zwicker, six for Carolina early.
My father always told me good big will beat good little all day long, 24-7. And that added height advantage of Zwicker paying dividends here in the early going. He's got two putbacks and a little 8-foot jumper.
7-2 is indeed big.
That's long, Brad.
Harpering's all alone. Georgia Tech can't find it outside the three-point line. Harpering will try in close and had it blocked. Georgia Tech 0 for 5 from outside the three-point line. McInnis maybe rushed one a little bit there.
That's an example of not taking the best shot available.
Great feed, Marbury to Harper.
excellent use of the bounce pass in transition. That's the only way that pass gets there.
Jamison, nice drive. Alisma rejects it. Georgia Tech comes up with a little defense of its own.
Head up, eyes ahead, looking for somebody behind the defense. Marbury finds Harpring. Fast break 101, folks.
Cuts it back to a six-point Carolina advantage. With 13:35 to go first half. From Atlanta, the Omni. This has been Georgia Tech's home along with the Georgia Dome so far this year. Marbury got a good look again. It's just not dropping. At some point, they probably will if Carolina continues to give them that kind of room outside the arc. Zwicker. Boy, he's done a little bit of everything.
Yeah, they can't bother him. See, that's a wonderful feeling to have as a post-up guy. When you can feel your defender and know he can't bother your shot. I had that feeling a lot, Brad.
Back it into Alisma, right back to Barry. Drew way off the mark on that three-point.
See, what's happening here, Brad? In the first two games in the ACC, Georgia Tech has shot 55% from the floor, and they've shot it extremely well from behind the arc. Those shots aren't falling, so now their weakness shows. They really don't have an inside game. Carolina going to sit in the zone and force them to make some outside shots. So Georgia Tech going to have to get high-quality shots and knock a few down, or defend, rebound, and try to get some before the defense is set up.
Double team on Calabria. Dante gets it out to Geth, who just checked in. Ten on the shot clock. They cross court it. Open three. Doesn't go, but Carter got his own rebound and stripped away by Barry. Tech runs. And Barry will pull it back out. And then go baseline to Marbury. Good luck to Maddox, but stripped away inside. Now Alisma is fouled. Well, that's good ball movement by Georgia Tech, even though they didn't get the basket.
Yeah, you can live with all of that as you see Bobby Cremins applauding the interior passing. Good decision here by Barry to pull it out and see what he's got. Marbury knows help is coming and finds Maddox. And then because of all that action, the defense is scrambling. Alisma able to get to the offensive glass.
Maddox will take a seat. Eddie Alisma will step up for Georgia Tech. He is... The last five games really started to put his game together and raise those averages to 8 points and seven rebounds, as you see. But he's never going to be known as one of the all-time great free throw shooters in the country.
That is a mild understatement, partner.
42% coming in, and it just got a little bit worse. Got the second. 16-9, North Carolina. Tar Heels swept the Yellow Jackets in their battles last year. Good backdoor look. Calabria got three. Had to adjust his shot a little bit thanks to Saunders. Now Marbury the other way. Harpring's wide open.
Yeah, he's falling away before he releases that. He's not staying with the shot quite long enough.
Georgia Tech now 0 for 8. Outside of the line. Jamison works inside. Strong move.
So quick off his feet, Brad. I mean, Alisma's in good position there, but he's so quick, he's like a pogo stick in there. 13 of his 17 rebounds so far in the ACC are on the offensive glass.
Advantage 9 for North Carolina. Barry, Tech's going to keep trying. Jamon Williams, who just came in, hooked on one of his own. Stephon Marbury, good position for the rebound. Ahead to Harpering, Williams. Well, we're going to say Harpering last touch. Too appreciative of that call, nor is Bobby Cremins. His team trails by 9 with 11:06 to play first half. Antawn Jamison, is he not one of the best freshmen in the country
and one of the more undersung and unheralded ones coming in? Quick off his feet, go to work, young fella. Nice little jump hook in there, got his body on the defender and then beat him up in the air.
Carolina and Tech both 2-0 in ACC play coming into this one. And of course, we followed the Wake Forest Duke game. And a tight one. This one not as tight, and Zwicker is part of the reason. He's got 10.
All they want to do is get the most high percentage shot they can get each possession. And that means making the extra pass, and they do it as well as any team in college basketball. Until your good becomes better and your better becomes best, don't ever let it rest.
That's Marbury's not resting.
That's Carolina's motto in terms of shooting.
You are quite a poet, my friend.
I had to dig into the archives to pull that one out, but it fits this Carolina team in terms of how they look for shots.
Okulaja, nice look down low. Jamison had it blocked by Alisma. Zwicker trying to follow. Got to be some kind of contact under there. And the foul on Serge Zwicker.
Dean Smith likes the effort of his big center. He's been a force inside. Again, Georgia Tech has nobody that can challenge him in there, and he's just not so much out jumping people as he is out reaching them.
Clemson leading Virginia. Clemson for real?
Possibly.
Tell you what, they're playing great right
they
now.
They really are. How about Pitt drilling Georgetown?
Unbelievable.
Man, it is absolutely wild all over the college basketball landscape.
And Clemson and Carolina get together at the Smith Center at 1 o'clock Sunday. That ought to be something special, considering Coach Barnes and Coach Smith have not seen necessarily eye to eye in Rick's first season last year. Good move by Eddie Olisman.
Well, that's one way to maybe negate Zwicker. Oops.
He's got 12.
Serge getting busy.
He is surging here as Carolina leads by 9. He might be on his way to a career high. He's got a dozen already.
And he's got 12 of their 22. The point I was about to make is that Eddie Olisma maybe attack Serge a little bit. Go at him some. Maybe make him use a little energy defensively. And in that way, maybe you can negate what he's doing at the offensive end.
They got it into Eddie, but he kicked it right back out to Maddox. 7 on the shot clock. Tech's going to have to hurry one. Barry dribbles through traffic, knows where that clock is, and buries it just before the buzzer. It's a big shot for Tech. They could ill afford a shot clock violation with the way things have gone to open up this game.
Good call. They can't afford empty trips.
Nice adjustment in midair by Jeff McInnis, and he's got 5. Saunders, who gave Tech a lift in the first half last week against Maryland with his 3-point shooting, he could help him out from the outside. Alisma faces Wicker, and he goes over the top.
Absolutely love it, Brad. He's square doing just what he needs to do against the bigger guy. When you're playing against a bigger guy and you're in the post, don't go with your back to him. Face him. Try to use your quickness.
And Barry forced that turnover. The Tech could cut it to 5 or 4 if that goes, and it does. 24-20. Tech fans finally have something to cheer about.
And they've been on their hands most of this half.
Because their team was 1 for 9 from outside the arc before Barry hit that one.
There's something special about seeing that 3-point shot go down for the home team.
It can ignite a crowd and a team. It's helped Georgia Tech. Okulaja trying one of his own. He's got 2 of them. Just that quickly, the crowd is quieted. Saunders, he'll try one. Got it.
Watch out.
Here we go. Under 7 minutes, first half, 27-23. Carolina, they have led from the outset. Marbury played for the steal. Jamison underneath. And all of that really started with a man advantage with Marbury playing for the steal, and all of a sudden it was 5-on-4, and Carolina knew it.
You've been doing some basketball the last few years, haven't you? Great call, Brad. Great call. One guy gets out of position, you've got a numbers advantage, penetration, help comes, find the open guy. And Antawn, an excellent finisher, good pass by Okulaja. That's money. That's like going to the ATM. Real easy once you got that secret code and you made a few deposits.
Here's the guy with a card. Let's see if he can get a three out of it. Nope, just two. Harpering with a rebound. 6-point advantage, Carolina. Harpering, nobody near him. And that one rattled out as well. Harpering is struggling.
Nobody on that weak side board either for Georgia Tech.
Calabria, nice touch pass. Okawaja, and now they move it inside. Tried to get it to Zwicker, and Berry with a rebound and a timeout.
Official timeout.
6 minutes, 21 seconds to go first half. Georgia Tech has closed it to a 6-point Carolina advantage.
Taking it to the Hoyas. Chad Varga will miss the jump hook. Watch Gerald Jordan slide in, not boxed out. He throws it down. Meanwhile, the second place team in what we'd like to call the Gavitt division, also trailing. Providence over Syracuse. The standings bunching up.
McGee's night. ACC night here. Carolina leading Georgia Tech 29-23. And more ACC basketball coming up this weekend. Maryland will take on 8th-ranked Wake Forest. Then it's St. Peter's in Manhattan. It is a quadruple header, by the way, on Saturday. Those are the first two right here on ESPN. So just turn on your TV, basically, and watch hoops from, like, in the morning until you fall asleep or pass out at night, whichever. Carter outside. Up and thought that one was going to stay up there with a shot clock. Dean Smith, 841 career victories.
Sometime next year, that record's at top. Was that correct?
Yep, that's
the
right.
All-time wins record?
Coach Rupp's 876 will be in some serious danger next year. That'll be fun to watch. Who knows how long he'll coach? We were talking about that before the game. I told him before the game, I'll retire from sportscasting before he's done coaching.
He looks like he's moving around quite well, seems to enjoy what he's doing.
His golf game flourishes. Carter trying to get it back to Calabria. Didn't seem like a good idea, but it pays off. Dante with four. Georgia Tech does not want to get in a turnover situation against this team either. But Marbury will help the cause. Stephon's first triple, his 35th of the year. And it's 31-26. Zwicker caught it in low. Triple team. Harpering trying to help out. Serge still got it off. But Harpering hung in there with him.
Nice look to Hodge.
Put everybody to sleep, Brett. He went down that lane nonchalantly with the intention of lulling the Carolina guys to sleep and then leaving it for Hodge.
Crowd is up at the Omni. That'll slow it down a little bit. Carter with his first bucket of the night.
Georgia Tech unable so far to get consecutive stops. That's why they can't really mount any type of surge. You need to come up with stop if you're going to put together runs. They've yet to do that.
We saw that problem last night with Mississippi State against Kentucky. Same problem. Foul as Harpering drove the lane.
Here we go.
This is one of those delicious dimes here. Drew Berry head up, just looked off the defense.
Vince Carter sort of said, how do you do that?
He's wondering who was behind him. He didn't see Hodge behind him. And Zwicker was slow getting back.
Now Drew Berry closing in on 100 assists already, and we're early in the season. There's Harpering's numbers, leading Georgia Tech in rebounding. And a 78% free throw shooting. Five boards for Matt tonight.
I tell you what, if you can just put the isolated cam on him, viewers, and just watch how he works at both ends. I mean, he just leaves it out there every night.
It's surprising he has a butt left when the night's over, because he works it off, that's for sure. 33-30. Again, it's down to three. Just over 4 minutes to go in the half. All Carolina at one point, but Georgia Tech has scrapped its way back in. McInnis working against Marbury, kicks it out to Calabria. Dante off the mark. And Carolina will maintain possession.
Well, Bobby Cremins, the last couple of minutes, has gone with Hodge to give him a little more size to try to deal with Zwicker inside.
They're dealing a little bit better than they were earlier. Georgia Tech trails Carolina by three. by three, just under 4 minutes to play in the half. Coming up on ESPN tomorrow, triple header action. The Golden Gophers of Minnesota take on Penn State in their brand new building with a top 20 ranking. Then it's Kansas and Florida in the SEC at 9:30. We'll top it off at midnight. Utah State hosts Southern Illinois. A triple header tomorrow night on ESPN. Brad Nessler and Clark Kellogg from the Omni in Atlanta. 33-30. North Carolina with the lead and the ball, but the ballpark didn't last too long. They just threw it away. Georgia Tech started off 1-for-9 outside the arc and have warmed up now the last couple.
Both of these teams really shooting the basketball exceptionally well to start the conference season. And that's pretty much how Georgia Tech is going to have to play. They're not big enough or strong enough on the glass, I think, to be a good, strong running team. But how about Hodge going to work inside?
It's about the strongest move Bucky Hodge maybe has ever made in a Georgia Tech uniform. Over Zwicker and a chance to tie this thing up.
He's got ample frame to work with now. And he puts it all on Zwicker and then throws up the jump hook. Hoop and harm.
Bucky.
They can tie this thing up, huh?
Bucky has put on about 15 pounds since last year. I think more importantly, he's redistributed the other weight that he had last year. And he does tie it up. Three-point play. Alisma and Barry get a chance for a breather, and all of a sudden, we have a ball game.
And this could really be key if Hodge can continue to make a positive contribution. Gives him a bigger body, and it also keeps some starters fresh.
Trying to feed it inside. Turnover, Georgia Tech 2-on-1. Hartman, Georgia Tech leads for the first time tonight. Look, Elijah working against Hartman. And that's Carolina playing from behind for the first time. Okalaja has some trouble. Got the pass away. Jamison got his own miss. Ties it back up. Marbury, boy, had Harpering flying in on the flank, and that caught somebody's foot en route.
Antawn Jamison really attacks that offensive glass. He's not eating glass on that offensive board. He's just swallowing it. I mean, 14 of his rebounds now in conference play on the offensive board, Brad. That's amazing.
It sure is. Barry back in. Saunders and Hodge did a nice job in their relief duty. Marbury, the three. And Maddox will track it down on the baseline. Barry packs it in to Marbury over Zwicker.
Good look.
37-35, Georgia Tech. Good battle going on between Calabria and Barry, a couple of seniors. Okalaja outside, he likes it out there. He's hit a couple of threes, that one doesn't go. And Alisma to Barry. Marbury had a notion. Ooh, what a spin move that was.
Boy, they could look at Maddox now. He's got Calabria on him. If they swing it back to Marbury, Maddox could post up Calabria.
Got about a 3-inch advantage in that department. 10 on the shot clock. Maddox outside. He can hit out there.
What am I talking about? Talking about post him up. He wants to shoot a three.
He loves to shoot it out there. His seventh three of the year, and it gives Georgia Tech a 5-point edge. What a turnaround in this half. Elijah almost walked with it and then threw it away. Zwicker couldn't handle it as it ricocheted off Marbury. And Coach Smith, does he want to talk about it? He's going to take a 20 to try to get his troops back in the hunt. A minute 35 left. Coming up on the Deuce, Florida State and North Carolina State on Saturday. Reynolds Coliseum in Raleigh, Florida State. James Collins, their leader, and North Carolina State has Todd Fuller down low. UMass and Rhode Island will follow at 2. That's women's college hoops. That's our nothing but net doubleheader, and it just keeps on going. 18th ranked Arizona takes on St. Joseph's from Philadelphia, and then number 25 New Mexico at Wyoming. All that action Saturday, nothing but net on ESPN2. Georgia Tech a 5-point advantage, a 17-4 run in the last 4 minutes.
And you know what? I think the catalyst has been Bucky Hodge, Brad. The fact that he came in, gave him an inside presence, gave him a big 3-point play, and allowed the starters to get a little bit of a rest up front. And now Georgia Tech has become a little more confident and aggressive defensively, and that's fed over to the offensive end of the floor.
Hodges, the guy that tied it at 33. Since then, Carolina has only one bucket. Harpring lost it on the dribble. That's sort of a sarcastic smile from Coach Kremins, I'll tell you that much. A minute left in the half, which means this will be along with our halftime report momentarily.
Chris, is Digger hanging out in there with him tonight?
I think Digger's with him. Zwicker in low. Strong move by Serge. This is as good a half as he's ever had in Carolina Blue. 14 with a chance to add to it.
Big fella just going to work in here, slipping down to the low post. Catch and finish in one motion. Maddox guilty of the foul. And again, when you're giving up that much size, it's tough to challenge a shot.
Chris and Digger, the Della Fawcett halftime report, less than a minute away. Virginia and Clemson's battle, a big upset in the Big East. Sean Kemp and a guy named Jordan who used to wear these colors. All that and more at halftime.
Those Bulls have been on a roll towards 70, possibly, Brad.
Just a little bit good again, aren't they? Marbury, there's a guy that's a little bit good.
Yeah, I like it, Stephon. He just gave me the eyes and the nod. Yeah, you got big game, young fella. Just keep working at it.
He's got cool way beyond his years.
Yeah, I talked to him about that. His older brothers have played a big part in that in terms of helping him know what he needs to do to get to that next level.
Carolina walks with it.
You know, he's already stretching like an NBA type guy into the martial arts a little bit, understands that he needs strength, not necessarily weight and bulk. You see so many young guys come into college ball thinking they've got to bulk up and get stronger, where basketball is a game of quickness, timing, reaction. You need strength, but it needs to be lean strength. You don't need a lot of weight a lot of times.
Georgia Tech, its biggest advantage of the night is up to 6. They'd like to add to it before halftime. That is the clock in the corner. Marbury looks up. Berry looks up. He'll be the man with the last shot. And it comes off the front of the iron. Dean Smith looking for an offensive foul call on Berry. Didn't get it. But Georgia Tech trailed all the way up to the point where it was 33-30, and then Bucky Hodge, maybe with the move of his young Georgia Tech career, tied it up at 33, and Tech goes on to a 43-37 advantage as we send it to our Delta Fawcett halftime.
Transition had a 3-point play that actually tied the game up. And from that point on, Georgia Tech's been in control.
55% from the field for Georgia Tech in the first half, and that is un-Carolina-like, if you will, because it didn't seem anybody ever shoots 50% or better against North Carolina. Mayor Campbell in attendance tonight. Gave the pregame pep talk to Georgia Tech, and I walked by him on my way to take a break here at halftime, and he said, Brad, you know, it took him about 5 minutes. It was a delayed reaction for them to understand what I told them before the game.
As long as it eventually sunk in, that's the bottom line. Mayor Campbell in an intense conversation there.
Big Georgia Tech fan, obviously, and awaiting the Olympics 191 days from today here in the city. So Dante Calabria and Drew Berry right in front of us, set to get it underway to start the second half.
Jamison was only 3 of 10 in that first half. He had come in having made 26 of his last 32 in the last two games.
Elijah looked down low, brought it back to Calabria. They're going to pack it into Zwicker and start the second half the way they started the beginning of the ball game. Let's see if North Carolina changes things defensively to allow Georgia Tech all that room outside the three-point line.
Well, they were in that zone a good part of that first half. Oh, what a feed.
Great feed by Berry. Got up in the air, faked the shot, and got it to Harpering for the easy deuce.
And that's a pretty tough catch in close quarters, Brad. I mean, there was only about 3 or 4 feet between the players. Good hands by Harpering.
sixth assist on the night for Drew Barrett.
And that's against only a couple of turnovers.
McInnis against Barrett. Harpering will pull off the miss. Maddox a three. Okalaja will pull off the rebound. Georgia Tech shot 86% inside the arc in the first half, 12 for 14. It was just that they were so cold outside the three-point line early.
5 of 17 from behind the arc.
And a push on Eddie Alisma from behind. That's Eddie's first foul. You got to give him credit for not getting in foul trouble against the much larger Serge Wicker. Serge 7-2, 265, and he's all of that. I remember the year that he redshirted and watching Carolina practices and how long he would practice before they worked out, how long he would practice after he worked, after they worked out, and hey, it paid off.
Oh yeah, nothing like perseverance and hard work. There's no shortcuts to getting better. Sure, some guys are a little more gifted than others, but when you work, you get better.
Drew Barry getting better now as this game goes along. It's his second three of the night.
Him and Dante right at the start. Look at him. They're chatting. They're chattering a little bit.
They were talking.
Yeah, they were talking right before the half started.
Yeah, they were talking in pregame warm-ups, too. Two guys, I think, that enjoy playing against each other. And Harpering with the hold before the move to the basket. That's his first foul. Shamon Williams is going to come in. Calabria will sit.
Second team foul. Number three, Shamon Williams, for the Tar Heels.
So Georgia Tech with its largest advantage of the night. They're up 9, 48-39, and that is the biggest lead that North Carolina had in the first half. They were up 18-9 at one point. Whoa. Wide open on the backside was Jamison, but the ball hit the bottom of the backboard. Marbury comes the other way. Strong rebound by Mathis. And now way up there, Okalaja pulls it ahead, 3-on-1 Carolina. Barry well held his ground, but Jamison hammered it home.
Well done. They got both lanes filled. That's what you need in transition basketball. So often you see the guy with the ball and only one lane filled.
Harpering with a three. Drew Barry still holding the back of his head after that collision with Jamison on the other end. Georgia Tech by 10.
Now Carolina's got to do a better job of tagging the shooters, Brad. They're late getting the shooters, and Georgia Tech making them pay.
It was okay at the beginning of the game when Tech hit one of their first 10 out there, but now that they've warmed up, Carolina's got to start getting out to the shooters, as you're talking about. McInnis, nice penetration, but nowhere else to go except to Williams outside. And now Jeff will take one of his own. Got it. Big shot by McInnis. Eight for Jeff. And that cuts it back to 7.
Carolina back into the zone. 2-3. Which means with ball reversal and movement, you'll get those wing jumpers. And Georgia Tech has been knocking down here in the second half.
Barry's got an opening. Didn't take it. Marbury. He'll drive into traffic. Nice look into Alisma from Barry, but blocked inside. Eddie with a second try. This one's good. And a foul and a chance for a three-point play.
Boy, that is a beautiful feed by Barry. An excellent perseverance by Alisma. Watch this feed. Barry knows where he wants to go with this before he caught it. He knew that defense was shifting out to him. The shot blocked initially, but E-squared. Showing you excellent effort there, and you'll have a chance for a three-point play. But we said it last week when we had Georgia Tech, as Syracuse holds on to beat Providence by 2. But we said it last week. With Georgia Tech, they seem to feed off of how Barry is playing.
That's
because
right.
He's a fifth-year senior. His emotion, energy level, and how he's playing has a lot to do with how successful this team is.
Successful enough to be up by 10 over the 10th ranked team in the country. Long way to go, though. Okalaja, long way out, rattles a three off. Alisma will clear it. Barry, again to Maddox.
That created by a poor shot. That shot by Okalaja was the first pass in the fast break there.
Crowd electrified at the Omni now. Georgia Tech leads by a dozen. Get a strong move on a crossover dribble, and he drew a foul inside. Eddie Alissmo will pick it up. That'll be his second. Drew Barry, his dad's here tonight. We talked about the fact that Rick's in attendance, and you know he's got to be loving some of the assists to the tune of seven right now.
Yeah, and that, the big thing is the one turnover, Brad. I mean, the dimes are wonderful, but if you're turning it over, that negates them. When he's in the open court, just get your hands ready if you're a Texter. Just get ready to catch one. And he gives it to you where you can score.
Exactly.
I mean, he's not going to give you a pass where you have to do something with it. All you have to do is put it in the hole.
I was talking to him one time last year. A lot of those no-look passes, I said, you got to watch out who you throw those to. Freshmen can't handle them. They don't know where they're coming from. Well, these aren't freshmen anymore, the exception of Marbury, and they know where those passes are coming from now. 15:39 to go. The mayor thinking that pregame speech is paying off. Tech leads by 11.
Overtime comes up short on the three-pointer. The foul at the buzzer inconsequential, and the Orangemen improved to 12-2. Brad Clark.
All right, Chris. Rick Barry looking on. That Barry kid can probably already shoot at least 60% from the free throw line. Unlike Rick, who was about a 90%er. And Drew Barry's dad in attendance tonight, and his son has put on a show with his passing again, Clark.
A 3-1 assist turnover ratio here in the first two games in the conference. And there's another one here tonight. I think we last showed that he had seven with only one turnover. So improving that assist to turnover ratio as we speak. And there you see what he's done in his career.
All 3 years leading Georgia Tech, 2 years leading the ACC. If he can lead the ACC again this season, he would join Muggsy Bogues and Phil Ford, who's an assistant coach on the Carolina bench, is the only players to accomplish that feat three consecutive years.
Yeah, that's pretty select company when you talk about guys who found open people for hoop.
Georgia Tech has outscored Carolina 33-14 over the last 12 minutes.
And it's kind of been a gradual thing, Brad. It hasn't been one that we would label spurt ability. But they've gotten high-quality shots and have buried all of them here since about the 10-minute mark of the first half.
Speaking of burying one, Barry just buried one. 59-45.
The Carolina zone is far too soft. At some point, you wonder if they're going to try to go man-to-man.
Saunders will get called for the push, trying to get the rebound on the baseline. Coach Smith a little bit beside himself. His team looked exceptional the first 10 minutes. And even in your 35th year, what has happened over the last 12 or 13 minutes is enough to make your head shake.
Well, they've been slow rotating defensively, and then on a couple of offensive possessions, they've taken some poor shots.
Marbury goes down, favoring an ankle, now trying to get out of the way, and now they'll blow it dead as Wicker hammers home his 18th point. And you hope that this was just getting kicked in the shin if you're a Georgia Tech fan. And about 15,000 people holding it collected breath right now on Stephon Marbury. Bobby Kremen says, you're going to be okay, and wraps him on the back. I don't know if that'll work or not. That's kind of a new medicine here.
It's the medicine of all coaches, though, with key players.
Got him up.
Let's see if we can find out what happened here. Excellent possession here by Carolina. Again, as we showed you at the top, looking for the best play, the best shot, rather. And Marbury actually... Another angle.
There it is.
There he is.
Like he stepped on Zwicker's
foot. Right, he just stepped on Zwicker a little bit there.
And when you step on Serge's foot, that's sort of like stepping on a barge out in the middle of the water someplace. Zwicker, by the way, has tied his season high. That last jam gives him 18 for the ballgame. Picked up by Vince Carter. Harper. No good on a three, way short. Here comes McInnis on the run. And Jeff will back it up. 59-47. cross courts it. Wide open three is short by McInnis. And now Barry brings it down. Saunders, air ball on a three-pointer. And Barry went for the shoestring tackle and picked up the foul.
Probably not a bad foul, nope, because Carolina looked like they were going to have a chance for an easy one.
First foul on Barry. This has been a relatively foul-free game on both sides of the ball. With 13:53 left, Georgia Tech leading 10th-ranked North Carolina by 12, and they are working the left ankle of Stephon Marbury. Alisma got a hand on the rebound and knocked away by a North Carolina player, so it'll be Georgia Tech ball.
Looks like they'll just retape Stephon's ankle and try to get him back out on the court. And the sooner they do that, the better, as he stays warm. The longer he goes with no activity, the tougher it'll be for him to come back and get going again.
That one's going to hurt tomorrow if it doesn't already. Alisma, good thought, trying to get it to Maddox in the paint, knocked away. It's the most important ankle in the city of Atlanta right now. It's Stephon Marbury getting retaped. Georgia Tech will slow things down a little bit. They can't slow it too much. Five on the shot clock. Barry, let's go from three-point range. Harper in. And a step back over his wicker.
Boy, great work, though.
Surge will clear off the second miss. Carter. Got it back. Stripped by Alisma. That looked pretty clean, but they're going to call a foul. Eddie thinks he had all ball. That's a personal foul against Alisman. Triple header coming up tomorrow on ESPN. Minnesota and Penn State. The Nittany Lions open up their new building. That ought to be beautiful. And right now they're playing great basketball. In Kansas and Florida, the SEC will top off our triple header with Southern Illinois and Utah State. Triple header night tomorrow night on ESPN. Foul is on Maddox, not Alisma. So three on Maddox, two on Alisma, and Michael's going to sit out, and Juan Gaston will check in for him. North Carolina struggling from the free throw line a little bit tonight. And that's not normally like North Carolina.
Well, they've really kind of struggled all year, Brad. Only 68% as a team.
Carter sits. McInnis comes back in. Carolina only has one foul this half. That's something to keep an eye on, too. Team fouls, one North Carolina and six for Georgia Tech. So speaking of free throw shooting, it could become a factor in Carolina's favor as we get on the final 12:45 of the ballgame. Gaston, who just checked in, trying to tip it in. And a foul. Okalaja, I think, on Harpering underneath.
Georgia Tech getting a little bit of penetration against the zone because they've knocked down so many from outside the arc.
They need this guy back in just to have the threat.
Exactly.
And his initial move on that bad ankle seems all right. Barry got the inbound pass, though. Gaston keeps it alive and threw it away. Did one good thing and then a bad thing. Gaston just off the bench in for Maddox. 12:38 left in the ball game. 59-48, Georgia Tech leads North Carolina by 11.
Well, I think Carolina's going to have to make an adjustment defensively. Not only is Georgia Tech getting good shots, but now they're starting to penetrate against that zone and get offensive rebounds.
Some excellent three-point shooters on the floor for Carolina. And Williams and Calabria. But Jamison goes up strong, Harpering stronger on the rebound. Wheels, first shot of the night for him, comes up short. Alisma saved it to Marbury. And now nice hustle by McInnis. And he can't save it.
Boy, Bobby Crimmins is an animated one over on that bench, isn't he? We had him and Gary Williams last week. Oh, my goodness. We're talking about guys to get into it.
You talk about your pogo sticks. Those two guys will jump up and down a little bit. Marbury looks right into the teeth of Williams and lets fly with a three. Shamad will pull off the miss, though. Barry went for the steal. Calabria alone for three.
Got it.
We got to watch out for him, because if he gets warmed up, look out.
Oh, yeah, he can stroke it. He's about a 47-48% career three-point shooter, so he doesn't need much daylight either.
I told him before the game, the last time I did you was Florida State. You had eight threes, and he just smiled at me. Harpring coming alive in this second half. 13 for Harpring to go with 10 rebounds.
You know, Harpring's effort is so consistent at both ends that it's only a matter of time before he gets his averages. I mean, he just works too hard, and he's a good shooter as well.
Played his high school ball about 20 minutes up the road. Shamad Williams. We talked about the three-point firepower on the floor for Carolina, and it's coming to the forefront. Harpring blocked by Jamison. Carolina ball. With 10 minutes and 42 seconds left in the ballgame. Almost the midway point of the second half. Georgia Tech clinging to the lead, but it's been cut down to 7.
A solo job right here.
Cato with a huge rebound. Missed it. The tip is no good, and Marquette hangs on to win a thriller.
Well, they got a
Marquette
bunch of
up to 9-2. Iowa State drops to 11-4. A lot of close games tonight, guys.
Chris, I got a feeling this one's going to get closer before it's over. 61-54, 10:42 left. The Durham boys are in town. Woody Durham, North Carolina, voice of North Carolina for 25 years, and his son Wes, the voice of Georgia Tech sports. And those two, I know, have had a great time in town waiting this ball game, and it's given them all something to talk about, and us included. Brad Nessler and Clark Kellogg with you from Atlanta. Carolina started strong, Georgia Tech surge, and now Carolina trying to make a push. Calabria over to Okalaja. He missed an easy one. And Georgia Tech comes the other way. Georgia Tech's only had two turnovers this half.
Well, that's been the difference in their improved play. That and their better shooting, but typically if you're not turning it over, you're going to get better shots.
Past the midway point, second half. Top spot in the ACC on the line. And yes, it is early in the season, but it's still a huge game.
Look at Harpring work. That was a poor pass by Marbury because he didn't allow Harpring to establish himself in the post there.
And the momentary change of possession, the shot clock restarted. Georgia Tech threw it away anyway. So just when we talk about turnovers, they have a couple in a row. Nice feed inside.
And Drew Barry is down, Brad. He never got back up after he went down.
Holding the back of his left knee or his left calf. And you just hope that it's just a cramp, but as his father looks on, we mentioned earlier how ironic it was that Drew Barry the past two seasons had been injured against North Carolina. And we hope that this is nothing serious. We'll maybe know by the time we get back from our break. 9:23 left. North Carolina has cut the lead down to 5 thanks to Jamison's jam underneath. To 5. Drew Barry on the bench. It appears that it's only a cramp in his left leg. At least the way they were working it, you got to hope that. Georgia Tech has cooled off.
Carolina has too.
Carolina inching its way back in, and they come up with another turnover. They want a 20-second timeout. McInnis on the floor didn't want a traveling violation called. Coach Smith, I think, could do without that timeout, but he didn't look too happy with it. But
they ambushed Georgia Tech there, Brad, right out of that timeout. Marbury picks his dribble up at the half-court line, got himself sandwiched between two Tar Heels, and then comes up. See, he wasn't expecting this. Never saw McInnis until it was too late. And then his teammates didn't help him there because they weren't ready for it. Excellent call and execution that time by North Carolina.
Marbury's been shaken up a little bit in this half. A bad left ankle. Drew Barry looks like he's set to go back to the scorer's table. Meanwhile, on the court, North Carolina, as we approach the 9-minute mark, has cut it down to a handful. It was once 14. It was 59-45 at one point in this game.
And you talked about the foul situation now. Carolina shooting the rest of the way. While they have four to give as a team, they only have two team fouls right now as Drew Barry checks back in for Michael Maddox.
Georgia Tech with a smaller lineup now, and Saunders, Marbury, and Barry. And there's a team foul situation Clark's talking about. Meanwhile, Shamon Williams, one of the best free throw shooters in the ACC, steps up. 86%. That's why. All his points have come this half, the sophomore out of Greenville, South Carolina. Had a good game against North Carolina State a couple of games ago.
Mm-hmm.
14-point outing in that one.
Yeah, he started in place of Jeff McInnis, right, who was out with that bruised thigh. And now Carolina in the position you want to be in when you're down.
Tex only had 2 points in the last almost 6.5 minutes of this ball game. Now they've got both Barry and Marbury on the court. Let's see if that makes a difference.
Tech has become, in my mind, just a touch tentative.
Yep.
And you knew North Carolina was going to crank up the pressure defensively.
Marbury foul on his way to the hoop. McInnis got him.
Yeah, that wouldn't even have counted in the NBA. We're a continuation.
Nothing can continue that long.
That's right.
Don't forget, scores at 10:30 and 50, past every hour, each and every day, 24 hours a day on ESPN. As you see some of the other scores from around the country, and our score, 61 to 58. As Chris Fowler said, it's a night of close finishes, and I got a feeling it's going to be that way at the Omni as well.
Carolina mixing up their defenses, back in that zone.
Harper had a pretty good look. Saunders tried to tip it in, and now it comes free, back to Saunders.
Tech needs a hoop here. They desperately need a hoop to keep this crowd in it and for their own morale.
Marbury to Harper. Everybody having a look and nobody pulling the trigger. Now the freshman will.
They got it.
Bobby Kerman says, that's why I spent all that time in Brooklyn.
Time well spent, because this guy can go.
Nice drive inside by Williams. He leaves it off. Okalaja with a big hook shot. He's got 8. 64-60. Marbury will try. This one's way short. Harpering with a little Lorenzo Charles thing underneath. Picked up what is going to end up being an assist for Marbury and a chance for a three-point play.
Swinger never saw the orange. Harpering kept his eye on it the whole time. Look at him work. I mean, this is what we talk about when we say keep active. Stay aggressive. Stay active. Keep moving. See, Okalaja never saw it. Harpering had his eye on it the whole time.
Serge picks up his third foul. Harpering, that's a strong double-double. And it's just getting better.
And this was a guy who wasn't that heralded, at least in basketball, coming out of high school.
Jamon Williams, and again, Barry hobbled. Williams wide open. Battling underneath, Jamison and Alisma. And Georgia Tech's going to finally win that battle underneath. Drew Barry's got more bad wheels than one of Bill Elliott's race cars right now, but he's still out there running around. Harper. Alisma tried to tip it. Zwicker will clear it off. Williams all the way down, Harpering with a steal. Marbury's out in front to Barry. Good look by Stephon Marbury. Georgia Tech stretches it back to 9. And the crowd starting to sense an upset, but still a long way to go. 6 minutes left and change. Williams, nice move inside.
They're hooping, Brad, at both ends. That's a great move to kind of quiet this crowd. In Carolina with McInnis and Williams out there, they've got two guys who can penetrate off the dribble. And that means maybe Calabria can get spot-up jumpers, or those guys can finish inside themselves.
Calabria's been pretty quiet tonight, no doubt about that. 7 points, only one three-pointer.
Yeah, like Drew Barry, he's had some nagging injuries this year, and you just never know how healthy he is.
Leans in. A three with three on the shot clock. 16 for Barry. Just when Carolina had made a push, Georgia Tech has pushed back. And we've got 5 minutes remaining at the Omni. Calabria, nice hook pass inside.
Yeah, you look at Calabria, you're right, he hasn't been much of a factor. And he's not moving real fluidly. He had a badly sprained ankle earlier in the year. You look at him and you can see he's favoring that ankle. He's not at 100%, that's for sure.
That he and Barry have had at times when they're on each other, they're not right now. It's really been fun to watch away from the ball.
Yeah, it's not all been physical either.
Nope.
There's been some verbal sparring going on too. A little jaw jacking taking place between those two.
Marbury, three on the shot clock. Came up short, but Tech keeps it alive. Eddie Alisma with a rebound. How big has Alisma been inside for Georgia Tech? And Bobby Crimmins wants to talk about it. A 20-second timeout with 4:15 left in the ballgame.
Yeah, he's going to diagram
Miller Dome. But tonight, it's rocking in here.
This is just a tough shot by Barry. He finds a little seam in the zone, gets McInnis to join the Paratroopers Club, and then just leans in under him. But that's a tough shot by Drew Barry. Sometimes you just have to tip your hat to the offensive guy.
Waited for the shoot to fall before he took the shot. Harpering, triple teamed, had it stuffed underneath. Carolina needed that stop. On the offensive end, who else? The freshman, Jamison with 14.
And he struggled compared to what he's normally done as far as shooting, but still unafraid to take big shots. He's got an excellent touch and a quick release.
Sauter's a good shooter. Rush that one, maybe. Zwicker with a rebound, and here comes North Carolina again. McInnis over Barry. Harpring battles the big boys and gets the ball back for Georgia Tech on the possession arrow.
Official timeout.
3 minutes, 29 seconds left in Atlanta. 72-66 Yellow Jackets. North Carolina State takes on 8th-ranked Virginia Friday night, 7:30 on the Deuce. A member of the world champion Atlanta Braves, Mark Lemke. He was in that Tech locker room before the game, too. That must have been a packed house.
Standing room only in there.
My team, the Braves. I can actually outrightly cheer for a team because I don't do baseball. World champs on the floor. Battle for the top spot early in the ACC season between Georgia Tech and North Carolina with 3:25 left and 15,243 looking on at the Omni.
Down in the winning time segment of a close game, you need to make sure you're executing. Screens have to be set, the ball has to be moved, and then obviously you need your big players, your marquee guys, to make plays for you.
And setting picks and going around him, and Calabria going around one of them, picks up his first foul.
Now he just doesn't have the push off of that leg. I mean, I've watched him all night, and he's actually laid on a few screens because he just doesn't have the strength to move as he would like to.
Fresh 35 on the shot clock with a little over 3 minutes to go.
Got to keep it out of that baseline, off that baseline in that corner. You want to stay in the middle of the court and along the wings against this zone. There you go.
Marbury for three. Too strong. Calabria the rebound. Dante with the outlet. A good one to McInnis. And now Shamal Williams. Excellent three-point shooter on the other end. Zwicker. Big rebound for Carolina. McInnis got up in the air and didn't have anywhere to go. He did get it to Jamison.
Yeah, he's left his feet a couple of times. As you look at Jamison, he took a shot to the chin. Not easy in that paint area.
Williams again open for three. Didn't take it this time.
We're looking at Harper work. Really trying to keep it out of Jamison's hands.
Try to leave it for Zwicker. He didn't go to the hoop. And an unforced turnover. Those kind Coach Smith can't even watch. He turned the other way on that one.
Yeah, well, they were all graped up. No spacing there, Brad.
All graped up.
Yeah, like grapes that, on the vine. Yeah. You know, just locked in tight.
You never cease to amaze me. 2:10 left.
Got to keep the alert, partner. Mm-hmm.
Using clock as it will now tick under 2 minutes. Maddox for three. Harper in the tip. How big has this kid played, especially in this second half?
He's a guy you can hang your hat on night in and night out, Brad. Coaches love those kind of guys.
Shimon Williams, that's a huge three and a timeout, North Carolina.
That has been a soft spot the last half dozen times down the floor against Georgia Tech. Shimon has parked himself over there, and Georgia Tech has not adjusted to his presence on that wing.
Coach Smith jumped off the bench, wanted a timeout, did not get it in time, and with 1:20 left, 5-point ball game. Harpring, double team, goes up anyway. Jamison pulls off the miss. Here comes the Tar Heels. 3-on-2. McInnis, triple. Big! Now they get the timeout. With 1:07 left, 2-point ball game. Georgia Tech 74, North Carolina 72. We'll be back. Matt Harpering playing like a dock worker for Georgia Tech tonight. As they are clinging to a 2-point lead with 1:07 left.
Here's Harpering working inside. Look at his activity. Got himself right in front of the rim for the tip in.
But you want to talk about, as we get another angle over Zwicker, inside Zwicker. How about the other end? Calabria knew it's not his night. Going to feed this thing out, back out to McInnis.
Well, two guys came at him. Barry and Marbury both attacked Calabria and Jeff McInnis. McInnis was trailing, and that's one of the best times and most ideal times to shoot the three in transition because, again, defenders are naturally taught to go to the ball and to gravitate to the paint.
McInnis with a little push, bumps Marbury, bringing it up court. As Chris Fowler said earlier, it is buzzer night around college basketball. Everything decided at or near the buzzer. We have 60 seconds left in this one.
That's when it's fun to be hanging out in that studio.
I tell you what.
You got those monitors going and buzzer beater here, buzzer beater there, upset here. Nothing like being in the house of a close one, though, either.
Coming down to this. Georgia Tech led 43-37 at halftime. They stretched it to 14 in this half. But North Carolina, with no quit in it, has come back to make it a 2-point game. And now Tech's going to use some clock before taking a shot.
Carolina doesn't have a foul to give, so Tech shoots on the next foul. I think you get it in Marbury's hands and try to let him penetrate.
Or Barry, and he has it right now with five. They'll double team him. Saunders is going to have to launch one. And he got it! With 1 second left on the shot clock. Pushes it the other way. We're under 20 seconds. Shimon Williams off the glass. All 12 of his points this half.
He's been large. Very large. Great play there. They didn't use too much time. About 10 seconds and they got the deuce in the timeout.
Georgia Tech had only had 2 field goals in almost a 5-minute stretch. And then with 1 second left on the shot clock, Gary Saunders, a 6'5 freshman out of New York, hit its biggest shot of the game, his biggest shot of his young Georgia Tech career.
Well, this is excellent defense by North Carolina. Challenging the ball, Okalaja maybe could have been a little more aggressive challenging in it, but that's a tough shot that goes down for Saunders. I mean, the shot clock about to expire. You don't want to foul.
Coming up next, Heath Overman and Carl Ravitch. They're sharpening their utensils to talk about the upsets in college hoops. Title news in the NFC and the AFC. A trade in baseball, all that and a lot more. Keith and Carl coming up in 14.1 seconds, barring overtime.
Here you see Bobby Crimmins trying to get his guys to get to the right spot. And just as important as being in the right spot is being strong with the ball when you get it. I would expect Carolina maybe to take a chance, 1, 2, 3 seconds to come up with a steal out of a trap. But after that, it's the immediate foul, and then you work yourself into position after that.
And the guys they would like to stay away from as far as fouling are Marbury, Berry, and Harpering, the three best free throw shooters for Georgia Tech. And obviously they're all on the floor, as is Maddox and Saunders. North Carolina 7-2 against Georgia Tech in this building, the Omni. But right now, Georgia Tech with 14.1 seconds away from an upset. Full court pressure as we expected. Berry's got a hustle, calls a timeout.
Timeout, Georgia Tech.
So we've still got 14.1 seconds left. Yellow Jackets will talk it over. We'll see what they do when we come back. 9 minutes. 45.9 seconds so far, and 14-1 left. Georgia Tech has seen what Carolina's going to offer in the form of pressure, called the timeout as they had trouble getting the ball in. And let's see what they do this time. Drew Berry will be the trigger man. Going to have to hustle again, and now a foul before they ever even got the pass involved. And that will send Stephon Marbury to the free throw line on the other end. Lynn picks up the foul. And now he'll come out and Jamison will go in.
Now, if Stephon Marbury can knock down two free throws here, what Georgia Tech wants to do is defend and try to make North Carolina use some time and not allow them to get a quick shot. And obviously, Georgia Tech, if two free throws go down here, they don't want to foul.
Pretty cool freshman. His first trip to the line tonight, and he rips it. Georgia Tech 7 out of 8 as a team from the free throw line. And they build youngsters that play so much more mature. Two big free throws by Marbury. 78-74. Now Tech needs some pressure, but they don't want to foul too quickly here. Big three-pointer. Okalaja, that is his third of the night. None bigger than that one. Are you kidding me?
Nope. Both of these teams outstanding shooting clubs, and they've struggled a bit in the second half in spots, but here lately.
Adimola. Okalaja with the shot of his young North Carolina career.
Created by the penetration of Shamon Williams, drew people to himself, then pitched it. And he's had a tremendous second half. Shamon Williams penetrates, draws people to him. And, you know, a lot of times when you're guarding a guy who's not really a three-point shooter, you leave him to help out. And that's exactly what happened. And Okalaja buried that thing. He shot that one like he meant it.
Like Georgia Tech's going to try to pass it two people out of bounds and try that play to try to get the ball in play, Clark.
And there you look at the reset. So Georgia Tech has a timeout. Carolina does not have any left. And also, Bobby Cremins has his three best free throw shooters in the backcourt looking to try to handle the ball. Harpring, Marbury, and Drew Barry.
Sports Center in 7.6 seconds if we don't go to OT. So now, if they follow Bobby Cremins' instructions, it'll be Barry to Harpring out of bounds. And there it is. Now right back to Barry, and he's fouled by Jamison. Well, I think that worked about as well as Bobby Cremins wanted it to.
Yeah, well executed. And by throwing it to Harpring, who stepped out of bounds, that gave Barry a chance to just come in and seal his defender.
Again, the look at the play that Bobby Cremins diagram. Barry to Harpring out of bounds and right back to Barry. And the quick foul. Well, we saw the freshman Marbury rip his two free throws, and now it's the senior captain's time. Carolina's out of timeouts, by the way. Barry missed it. Harpring had a hand on it. Barry got it back on the baseline. He pulled a David Copperfield on the baseline and got the ball back.
Harpring kept it alive, though. Harpring, we've talked about his activity and his effort all night long. As you look at Hall of Famer Rick Barry.
Rick Barry saying, I didn't teach him how to shoot free throws, but I taught him how to follow his miss. Look at that.
Well, I tell you what, Harpring kept it alive, but Okalaja, and it looked like Shamon Williams had a chance to get it. And one guy thought the other guy was going to get it.
And Drew Barry, with a second chance, doesn't miss. 2.5 seconds left. Carolina out of timeouts. Georgia Tech, if Barry hits this one, Carolina can still tie it with a three. Barry got them both. 80-77. Here's your game. Georgia Tech upsets 10th-ranked North Carolina.
Now, I don't believe this. You wrote down the score of this game before it started.
How about that? Georgia Tech 80, North Carolina 77. And to the top of the ACC heap go the Yellow Jackets. Carolina falls to 2-1 and 11-3 overall. A Georgia Tech team in search of itself a week ago on a losing skid, and now they have beaten Maryland, Duke, and North Carolina back to back to back. And Drew Barry, the two free throws that iced it. Well, 15,243 enjoyed their night in Atlanta, Georgia. The ACC off to a wild start, and who'd have thunk Bobby Cremins' Yellow Jackets would be to the head of the class with an 80-77 win. For Clark Kellogg and our entire ESPN crew from Atlanta, Brad Nessler saying so long. SportsCenter is next.